We're going to James chapter 1. We're going to begin reading here at verse, hallelujah, number 21. He goes, so wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your soul. Now, we constantly hear that it is the word of God that God has designed to save our souls. Then he says, the engrafted word. There's a difference in just hearing a word and something that's engrafted. When you engraft something, you put something into something and wove it into and become one with. You make it engraft a patch on your shirt. You stitch it on there. That patch is engrafted on that coat or that collar or whatever. When the word is engrafted in you, it means it is placed in you and it remained there and become a part of your reasoning. That's the only word that's going to save you. We can trick our own selves. We can believe a church is going to do it. We can believe if you get baptized, you're going to do it. You can believe if you shout hallelujah, it's going to do it. You can believe if you send off to the preacher and get. But only way your soul's going to be saved, Jesus said, you're clean through the words I've spoken. Here is James said, you got to receive the engrafted word. Meaning something that's placed in your conscience. And when you get ready to make decisions, the word of God is there, is determining your decisions. Most of us now, and I've been like most of us are, or were, most of us make decisions based on what feels good to us. We make decisions based upon what we feel is fun and pleasure. But the Bible said the pleasures of sin is only for a season. And what we don't realize when we're doing those things, we don't realize we are binding ourselves down and bringing ourselves short of what God has in plan for us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Surely the dope addict needs his drugs to survive as a dope addict. Surely the man that has an addiction to any abusive drug, a narcotic, he needs that narcotic to survive. But the thing is about this, he framed himself that way in his ignorance. He just thought he was going to feel good and learn what it was. He thought he was going to try this invention and move on. He didn't know it was going to change him. And most of us have not known our life's experiences has made us who we are. You can find it in people's conversation. You find a man with a temper like that. You tell you, man, I've been in Angola. I've been in Tucson alive. He'll tell you, some will tell you, man, I'm from the ghetto. They'll tell you their practice of life and their environment has framed them and changed them to be who they are. But through God's word, God is wanting to change you back to the initial state that he had you in the beginning and protect you that you don't have to live a life where you running from one drug to another, one woman to another, one man to another, no dignity about your life. You can raise up again and be honored, feel honor in your own self and with your family if you turn to God with a whole heart. Turn to God with all of your might and all of your strength and he'll lift you up. Shout glory to God, somebody. Hallelujah. I'm getting ready to let you go. Hallelujah. I love this in this book of James. Hallelujah. What he tells us in verse chapter 1 in verse 21 again. Wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. And receive with meekness. Humble yourself. The engrafted word, which is able to save your soul. And this is a warning to church people that hear the word, love to quote it, listen to it on tape. But be not doers of the word. Be ye doers of the word, rather, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Now, that's one way you can deceive yourself and nobody else have to trick you. You can deceive your own self. You're worried about a preacher being wrong, and that's a good thing to worry about. But what you're not worried about is you being wrong. You're worried about somebody at the church might trick you. But what about you tricking your own self? What about you tricking your own self? Tricking your own self to believe something is right and is wrong. I found out that the biggest trickster to me was my own desire. My own desire made me find it was all right to do anything I wanted to do. Through my own desire, I wanted to drink. You know, Jesus made wine. Hallelujah. I was filled with division. And I'd read in the Bible and find out where God separated them people over there, and he didn't want them all being together. See, I took the scriptures and things I heard and concocted to fit my own desire. We can trick our own selves. But if we let God's word be true, precisely what it says, and not try to twist it up, the truth will make us free. Give him praise in the house of God. Be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his face in a glass. And he beholds himself, but he goes away and straightway forget what manner of man he was. This is what the Bible says our hearer of the word and not a doer is. He hears the word of God, but soon as he's away from the presence of the minister declaring his error, he forget what was spoken, and he becomes very comfortable being the way he is. That's dangerous. That's dangerous. Hallelujah. But whosoever looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continues therein, being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deeds. And if any among you seem to be religious and bridle not his tongue, man, if you don't bridle not your tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. If you can't stop cussing, you can't bridle your own tongue. You can't stop being bitter. It says, you may have a religion, but your religion is vain. First thing God is wanting to do is to start taming your speech. You may not overcome all of this stuff, and you won't overcome it all at once. But I'm going to now take you through the final phase of this, how God plans to get you to this victory and what's causing you not to get to victory. Isn't that all right? Let's go to it. Let's go to Psalms 119 and verse number 9. Hallelujah. Wherewithal shall a young man clean his way? Then he answers the first as a question. Psalms 119 and 9. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? Then he answers, by taking heed thereunto according to thy word. This is just that simple. Taking heed to the minister. And the sad thing that really hurts me is that I've seen in so many families, God will have to save one before he saved the other. The sad thing, if you don't watch yourself, you can seek relationship with the one that's not saved and you can let it pull you down to both of y'all go to hell. But you need to have more stamina. Remember this. A sanctified wife will sanctify her husband. That's when she remains sanctified. A sanctified husband will sanctify his wife if he stays saved. Now he's telling you, you shall, wherewithal shall a young man clean his way is by taking heed according to thy word. Then he goes on to say, with my whole heart have I sought thee. Oh, let me not wander from thy commandments. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Now, here's the summit said, if I keep his word in my reasoning, in my mind, what he told me to do, what he told me to refrain from, when I'm sitting there contemplating, deciding upon a course of life to choose, if I keep his word, let it be engrafted in me. Let it stay right there and submit to it even when it hurts. It's going to change me. Hallelujah. Let's go to this here. Philippians, if you would. 1:29. And it said, for it is given unto you, for unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but to suffer for his sake. I want you to think about that. Christ, when he talks about you believing in God or believing in Jesus, he also coupled with your faith, he's given you a charge to not only believe him, but to suffer for his sake. What do you mean suffer? I'm going to show you. Hallelujah. Let's go over here with me, if you would, to 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 1. For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourself likewise with the same mind. For he that suffereth in his flesh has ceased from sin. He that suffers in his flesh has ceased from sin. Don't let people tell you, you got to keep sinning. Well, that is true if you don't make up your mind to suffer. You will have to keep sinning. You will. But the purpose, what you mean suffering is flesh? When the sinful desires come and God's word meet there with you at the same time, you feel the urge in yourself to follow your particular usual pattern. Whether it's to go to the magazine, whether it's to go to the strip club, whether it's to go in the corner back in where you know the dope bar is. Your mind is there, but God's word has been planted there, and there's a challenge going on. Most oftentimes, what causes you to continue to be in sin, you make a conscious choice. So I'm tired of suffering. This pain, I want this so bad, I want it just one more time. One more time. God's going to forgive me. Then you start the cycle all over again. You start the cycle all over again. And you feel, you come to altar and you feel convicted and you pray and ask God forgiving you. And God forgives you because you asked him. But you haven't overcome yet. And it's important for you to overcome this world. Jesus said, he that overcometh shall inherit all things. Oh, yeah, when you prayed and asked him to forgive you, he forgave you. But you're still the same person. You just got forgiveness. You got to be born again. You got to be changed. If any man is in Christ, he's got to become that new person. Once again, for as much then as Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourself likewise with the same mind. Your victory of this life comes from when you implant God's word in your mind and you purpose. I desire alcohol today, but I'm going to suffer. Hallelujah. I desire to go get me some lips, get me a woman. And I got the feeling and the urge. I'm not going to try to get an artificial. I ain't going to go to a Playboy magazine. I'm not going to go find me a secret corner so I can imagine in my mind the same thing. It can become very difficult. And sometimes feel like you just can't get free from it. But my Bible tells me, and I'm a living witness, you make up your mind, I'm going to suffer this thing. I'm going to church. I know what I'm going to get involved. I'm going to go do something for God. I'm going to go on the streets and witness to somebody. The devil going to tell you, how you going to witness? Look how you're tempted and how you're feeling. Brother, that's when you're able to witness. Hallelujah, because you come from that. Now the devil wants you to go back, and once you go out and start witnessing, telling folks about where you come from, you're going to start saying, God, I thank you. I'm not engaged anymore with that. It's going to encourage you with strength and cause you to get victory over that thing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody hurt your feeling. Your old ways of getting the victory is tell them off. Go backbite on them. Go tell somebody something bad about what they did. No, you're going to suffer that thing. I'm going to suffer it. I'm going to take this thing to God. That's what I do. Y'all don't know, when I start saying I overcame this world, it was my pain that caused me to get there. And I'm going to tell you something. When you're going through pain, you don't feel strong at all. I don't care what nobody says. You don't feel strong at all because you are going through trials of your life. Jesus went through those same things. Have you ever read how Jesus overcame this world? It was in that Garden of Gethsemane. When he was knowing that he was about to face his crucifixion, not only being killed, he knew they was going to strip his clothes off in the front of the world. He knew they was going to beat him with a cat of nine tail and rip his back open. He was aware that he was going to get pierced in the side. This had been written before he came, that he had to go through with it. My Bible tells me that Jesus went and he got away and prayed. And he said, Father, if you be willing, remove this cup. I don't know where you are, but I've been there so many times. God, I'm tired of this. Take this away. Move this off of me. Make me where I don't make this mistake again. Make me where I don't speak when I should not. Make me where I can endure these things and not feel this way. I've done praying like that, but till I made up my mind, if God didn't make it, I was going to do what was right before. When I made my mind up to be that way, it looked like God launched me to another level. And those trials became where they were not even there anymore. I'm here to tell you, things that I used to fight with and struggle with, I'm not even bothered with them. Hallelujah. You're looking at somebody that's completely overcome this thing. And I ain't scared to tell the world that. I ain't scared to tell the world, and I'm not bragging on myself. But I know what God has done for me and what he's done on the inside. And he done it through pain and sorrow. And sometimes I made even mistakes in the midst of those pains and sorrow. Sometimes I had to repent for things I said, I shouldn't have said. Hallelujah. But I didn't give up and throw in the towel. I said, God, you got to help me. Hallelujah. You got to strengthen me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And let me tell you something. God is looking for somebody to bring through things that he can build others' lives with. Don't ever look at your life because you blundered or made a mistake that you lost out and it's no more good for you. That's false. That's a lie from the devil. The men that God used in the Bible were always men that had had great challenges like that. You find the Bible said David, I love reading about him. The Bible says he didn't violate the law or transgress the law, but in one case, all his days. And that was the case of Uriah the Hittite. When he went into Uriah the Hittite's wife, and he turned around and had Uriah killed. But you find David did not quit. David had more right to quit than anything, his own pride. He had been prophesying. David didn't just start prophesying. He had been prophesying. He was a preacher before that. God used him as a child to kill. I'm telling you, I'm talking about David went out and fought lions and bears, beat them with his hand, God's spirit on him. But it came a time in his life that he erred. And the preacher, the prophet Nathan, came to him. And he gave him a parable about this rich man that had many flocks and sheep. That's how your message is going to come to you in church. I'm not going to come directly to you in your home and tell you precisely what you did. I'm not going to tell you, you wasted the beer on the floor and your husband hit you and you tried to cut him. David came and was talking about a rich man had flocks and sheep. And how that a traveler came and the rich man wouldn't take his own sheep. He looked out there and saw one little poor man had one little ewe lamb. And he took it and slew it and gave it to his guest. And then he turned around and slew the poor little man. David was first hostile. The man that did this thing ought to be killed. David didn't know that that was a parable for him. What that says to me, sometimes we can sit in church and we can see a word going to everybody else, but never see your own wretched self. But I can promise you it never helps you until you can see you, till you can recognize who you are. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. David said, a man that did this thing ought to be put to death. Bring him here. The prophet Nathan had no fear. He said, David, you are that man. Hallelujah. David was a king. He could have had Nathan killed. Because he knew Nathan, with Nathan doing this, this thing could spread everywhere. He could have had him slaughtered. But David knew you can when you're trying to get out of sin the wrong way, you only dig yourself in a deeper hole. You want to quit this wife? You don't like the way she cook. She done got too fat now. And you're going to dig out by trying to do something else. Some people even hire folks to be killed to try to get free from a marriage. I'm going to tell you something. You're going to be the one suffer in this stuff. I don't care if you figure you never get caught. When God get through with your conscience in the way God, the Bible said, whatever you sow, you're going to reap it. And you never know when you're going to need mercy. The Bible said to the merciful, he will show himself merciful. Why not forgive your wife? Why not forgive your husband? You're still there at the house, but you're still mad. You're still holding grudges. And that friction there will not allow the love to flow. Sometimes you need to grab your spouse and say, let's get to the altar. Don't worry about who else is at church. Don't worry about who else see you. Hallelujah. You worry about, I'm going before God. I want this thing right with my father. When Nathan told David that, you are that man, David looked at that prophet, and you can read about it in Psalms 51. He said these words. He fell on his face and said, have mercy on me, O God, according to your tender mercies. Blot out my transgression. Hallelujah. He said, create in me a clean heart, O Lord. Renew a right spirit in me. Let the joy of your salvation come unto me, O Lord. Against you and you only have I done this evil. And you are justified when you judge me. He said, but Lord, he said, Lord, but if you clean me, I shall be clean. He said, I will teach sinners your ways, and transgressors shall be converted unto you. That's the thing I want to say to you. God has more pleasure in changing you than he does in killing you. God has more pleasure in forgiving you and lifting you up than seeing you on your face. Because you can't help nobody being down and out. And sometimes you go through things in life so God can humble you. So you can make, he can make you know you need him. But it is that man, once he finds out my ways have got me in trouble. God is looking, when I look throughout all the Bible and read the history, and that's what helped me in some of the trials of my life early when I got saved. When I got, when I first became a pastor, I was still in Houston. I was being fought so much, I thought the enemy would just had me. I even thought, I said, Lord, I can't preach to nobody. I ain't right myself. I said, Lord, ain't none of them preachers, Paul and them didn't go through what I'm going through. God said to me, you don't know what Paul went through. God said, I use men with infirmities, but I free them from these chains. So I can make them witness to others that are chained and in bondage.